overflowing. As the Lord commandeth you, bring your vessels, not a few. He will fill your heart today to overflowing with the Holy Ghost and power. Oh, He will fill your heart today to overflowing. As the Lord commandeth you, bring your vessels, not a few. He will fill your heart today to overflowing with the Holy Ghost and power. Grant it, Lord, tonight. Hallelujah. Shake hands with four or five folks and tell them how glad you are to see them in the house of the Lord. Well, I was glad when they said unto me. Well, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, let us go into the house of the Lord. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me, oh, let us go into the house of the Lord. Yes, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me, oh, let us go into the house of the Lord. Yes, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Well, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, let us go into the house of the Lord. Yes, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Well, I was glad when they said unto me, oh, let us go into the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. When I got into the house of the Lord, I found what I was looking for. Found help. Found peace. Found joy. Glory, glory, glory. Before we do anything else, lift your hands toward heaven. Father, have your will and your way in this place tonight. Touch every heart and every life. Minister and move by your power and by your spirit. Lord, we're looking to you. We believe you tonight, Lord, to quicken, to empower, to encourage. We've come to praise you and to magnify you, King of kings and Lord of lords. We bless your name. We bless your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Come ahead, Sister Amy.
I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. Oh, what the Lord has done for me. Yes, I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. Oh, what the Lord has done for me. Oh, sister, you don't know like I know what He's done for me. Brother, you don't know like I know what He's done for me. What He's done for me, I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. I get joy when I think about what He's done for me. Oh, what the Lord has done for me. Well, brother, you don't he's done for me. Oh, you don't know like I know what he's done for me. Oh, what the Lord has done for me. Well, I could shout when I think about what he's done for me. I could shout when I think about what he's done for me. Well, I could shout when I think about what he's done for me. Oh, what the Lord has done for me. Oh, no, I cannot tell it all.
Oh, bless his name.
I'll never forget
the day he came. Oh, he makes me glad when I am sad.
The dearest friend
I ever had. Now when I was drifting out of sin, I had no peace, no joy with him. Oh, bless his name. I'll never forget that day he came. Oh, he makes me glad when I'm sad. More I ever had. When Jesus comes, the way is bright. Friend, he's the way, the truth, the light. Oh, he cheers me on when I'm sad. Testify to that tonight. Oh, all my life. looking at this song, and that bridge says, your goodness is running after me. So that's from Psalms 23, where it says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow. And I looked at that Strong's definition of follow. And it literally means to chase after. It's the same word that's used when Pharaoh chased the Israelites to the Red Sea. It's the same word that's used when King Saul pursued after David. It's the same word that's used when Abraham said he gathered his trained servants and pursued to rescue Lot. So when you think his goodness is following me, it's not just a happy-go-lucky feeling. It's a pursuit that's meant to overtake you. And it says, all the days of my life, not just on the days that I feel good. This is from Psalms 23. When I dwell in the valley of the shadow, walk through the valley of the shadow, even there, his goodness is running after me. Hallelujah. Let's sing a little bit of that bridge. Your goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
And begin to praise him. Lift your voice and begin to magnify the Lord. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he heard me, delivered me from all of my fears. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless you as you're seated. Thank you, choir. Glory to God. Glory to God. It is a joy tonight to have Brother Paul Ecker and Teen Life Challenge here with us. Praise the Lord. It is an honor to have a newly wedded couple, Christian Holbrook and his lovely bride. Would you folks stand? Great to have you in the service tonight. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And we are blessed to be in the presence of the Lord. God is good, faithful. His mercies are renewed each morning. His compassions, they fail not. He's mindful of us. Knows exactly what you're facing and what need you might have. Casting all of your care upon him, for he cares for you. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. Started a revival last Sunday night, Brother Paul, in Joplin, Missouri. Monday night and Tuesday night, it was about 14 or 15 men came over from Teen Challenge of the Four States, was there with us in revival. And it was wonderful seeing them and seeing what the Lord is doing in the hearts and lives of individuals. We serve a miracle-working God. Every one of us in here, every one of us in here needed the miracle-working power of God in our life. Hallelujah. Ushers, come. We want to be a blessing tonight. Tonight, following the service, we are going to take them to eat at, I'm looking for my wife. So, Rosas, that's where it's at. We're going to Rosas, and church will take care of that. We will. I see some of them fist bumping, some of them going, oh no. But we're glad that they are here. I want to thank the church for your generosity in giving. God has blessed us and helped us. Went by the bank not too long ago, and the president of the bank said, could I talk to you for a moment? I leaned over. I don't hardly go to the bank. Sister Snow usually goes in. I said, who's that? She said, that's the president. I said, oh, no, what did you do? He took me in his office, and he sat down, and he said, what are you doing? I said, I just come in here with my wife. He said, no, I want to know what you're doing at your church. He said, I've watched, and he said, over the past couple of years, you guys have been doing something that's right because God is blessing you and helping you. I said, praise the Lord. He said, I see what you're giving. I know where things are going. He said, tell me the secret. I told him this. I said, do you know about church? He said, yes, I serve on the church board. I said, okay. When COVID hit, the first month of COVID, instead of pulling back from our missions, everybody that we gave double that first month. Instead of, I said, we wasn't having church. I was preaching up on the rooftop. I said, my father-in-law stood out there with an 8-foot pole because we was afraid we might catch something with a fish basket. And they drove by and dropped it down in the fish basket. But not everybody showed up for the parking lot. I said, we didn't know, but I knew what God spoke to my heart. I said, we gave all the staff raises. I said, we didn't get on the Titanic. This is the ship of Zion. It's going to sail. Can I tell you that God has provided and met every need, and it's because of your faithfulness in giving to the Lord. Tonight we want to be a blessing to this ministry. Father, we thank you for your goodness and for your grace. We thank you for the privilege to be in your house on Sunday night. I pray, Lord, that you would bless in this offering, bless the gift and the giver. Minister and meet every need of Teen Life Challenge. May they continue to minister and win souls for the kingdom. We praise you and we thank you for everybody that is investing in the kingdom now. In your name, amen. Thank you. answered by and by. When you feel a little prayer will turn and you know a little fire is burning, find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Well, I may have doubts and fears, my eyes be filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. Oh, I go to him in prayer, he knows my every care. Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Oh, let us have a little talk with Jesus, tell him all about our troubles. He'll hear our faintest cry, he'll answer by and by. Feel the prayer will burn, know the fire is burning. Have a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God bless you as you're seated. Got a word today and a picture that Corey went home from the hospital. We thank the Lord for that. Glory to God. What seemed to be last night in the late night hour, such a tragic news, but God come through and helped us. Amen. Glory to God. I have years ago was introduced to Brother Paul Ecker through a man by the name, I don't know if y'all know him or not, but Brother Terry Johnson. Back before the turn of the century in the late 1900s. In the 80s, I came to work at this church in the old sanctuary under Pastor Johnson, and he introduced me to a man who has become a friend and a dear brother, and his wife is here tonight, Sister Linda, and their daughter, and we love and appreciate them. And they are in the process of transitioning to retirement after 40 years of ministry over Teen Life Challenge in Dallas. We appreciate them. Amen. I want him to come, and the men are coming. Okay, men, come. Jump up here. Take your liberty in the Lord. Worship the King. Praise God.
Good evening. Hello. My name is Joshua Griffin. I am 27 years old, and I'm from Amarillo, Texas. How many of y'all been to Amarillo? Oh, wow, a lot of y'all. It's pretty dry out there. But I'm a PK. I was raised in church all my life. I accepted Christ at the age of 10. And by the time I was 15, God called me to the ministry to preach. I was excited about it at first, but then I got discouraged. It's like, God, there's no way I can do that. I can't be like my father. I can't get up in front of a crowd and speak and be a pastor. You're out of your mind. So I started walking my own way. I started drinking, smoking with my buddies on the weekend. And I always brought my little brother with me because he didn't have much friends. He was a small guy. He was bullied. So 2 days after my 21st birthday, he committed suicide. And I had to find him. And my parents were in St. Louis at the time. So I had to make one of the hardest phone calls I've ever had to make in my life. I had to call them and tell them that their baby boy was no longer with us. And a year after that, I started drinking, and I started just doing my own thing. And I was in a car accident, a head-on collision. And I'll never forget this. They put me on morphine in the hospital, and I got hooked. I used it to hide my pain for the next several years. And my parents told me about Adult and Teen Challenge in Amarillo, and I wasn't ready yet. I told them, no, I don't need that. I'm not bad. I'll be fine. I can handle it. And after being fired from my third job in 5 years, I realized it was time for a change. It was time to start following my calling and becoming a pastor. So as I was driving home, a song came on called I'll Find You by Lecrae. It's a Christian rap artist. And it spoke to me. He told me, go to Adult Teen Challenge in Dallas. Dallas? Why Dallas? There's one in Amarillo. Let's go to that one. So I did. I made it there a week. And this verse stood out to me. Psalms 8:32-8. The Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and I will watch over you. And the best pathway for my life was Adult Teen Challenge in Dallas, Texas. So I got 20 new brothers standing behind me now. And it's great. It's great. And I forgave myself for my little brother's death. And I, more importantly, I forgave him. So it's been great. And the verse I stand on is Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Thank y'all.
You call my name. My name is Jonathan Firm. I've been in this program before. I know Pastor Snow because one of my friends that went through the program, Tim Lester. Yeah, old Tim was a, I can tell he has a big heart because I had to live with him for about 2 years. Because I put up with him every day. But I went through the program in 2014 to 2017, and God changed my life. And, I mean, took me from all the addictions that I had and changed my life, restored my family, restored my relationship with my son, and the devil is, you know, is here to steal your testimony and take you back if you allow it. And he tried to do it to me, but I have a lot of friends and family that I've met through this program, and one of them was a boss that has graduated from the program, and I went to work for, and I worked for him for the last 7 years, and he pretty much saved my life. I was going down a path that was going to kill me, and it tried. I mean, I was in the hospital numerous times in the last year, and still I couldn't get myself out of it. But my boss finally told me, he said, if you're not going to be sober in a week, then I'm taking you to Teen Challenge. And I said, okay. And he wasn't lying. Came over to my house, kicked the door in, kicked my roommate out, told him to pack my stuff. And I was in the program the next morning. But it was, you know, it was me. I mean, through all that addiction, I was crying out to the Lord. And I know he's hearing me. And, you know, he works in, you know, higher ways than we even know. And I know he heard me. I know he heard my heart and brought my boss in to bring me in here. And I'm thankful for that. And I got so many scriptures going through my mind. But one scripture that's always been on my heart is one that I should have been standing on, which is trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding and acknowledge him in all your ways and guide your path straight. That's what I'm standing on. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Josh Dill. I'm from Mount Vernon, Texas. I'm 46 years old, and I've been doing drugs for 28 years. That's over half my life, and I really have no excuse to have done that. I was raised going to church. My parents were good people. I didn't even know what any cuss words meant or what they were till I was like in the eighth grade. I lived a real sheltered life, grew up on a dairy farm, milking cows. My parents owned the local grocery store and everything, but at some point I started running from God and started using drugs, you know, and I had a lot of blessings. I had a blessed life, man. I had college paid for, and I just had family that would help me in any way, and I just didn't appreciate any of those blessings, you know. And over time, along with my felony charges, I started accumulating medical problems. I've got diabetes. I've got hemochromatosis. It's a genetic disorder that makes my body build up too much iron. All that iron has got in my liver and given me stage 4 cirrhosis of the liver. I got thyroid disorder, vitamin D deficiency. And this last time before I went to jail, I got where I couldn't breathe. And I had to go to the emergency room, and they did x-rays of my chest and told me I had an enlarged heart, that I had congestive heart failure due to my drug use and everything, you know. And I started praying to God at that point to heal me and to save me, you know, because even after that, I couldn't stop using drugs, you know. I used to tell people that I came from a beautiful world, and I got lost in the forest of ugliness of my addiction, and I could not find a breadcrumb of beauty to find my way home. And, you know, I started praying to God to heal me and everything, but really I just wanted to heal so I can continue to use drugs, you know. But God then worked his magic and had me picked up off the streets and got me some new drug charges and had me dropped in jail. You know, he wanted me to just be still and know that he was the Lord. Amen. And I was praying and reading my Bible every day in jail and everything too. And you know, I was like Paul on the road to Damascus. I was blind to everything that God had been doing in my life, you know. And so I was facing 15 years in prison, and I had a drug-free zone charge enhancement on there. So I was looking at 5 years minimum before I was even eligible for parole, you know. Or I got blessed with the choice of Teen Challenge. And since I've gotten to Teen Challenge, the scales have been removed from my eyes. I've seen all the miracles that God was working in my life, all those breadcrumbs of beauty, you know, and I'm going to keep following those breadcrumbs all the way home to my true home in heaven where God is leading me, you know. And since I've gotten a Teen Challenge, God's put it in my heart to use my weakness as a strength. I want to become a substance abuse counselor, a Christian substance abuse counselor, and help other people overcome their addiction as well. And if you people, I know y'all have loved ones. Everyone knows an addict somewhere. God is at Teen Challenge. I promise you. You know, send them there, and they will be healed of their addiction, man. It's a powerful place. It's a really, really good place. But the verse I stand on is Psalms 119, 30 through 32. I have chosen the way of faithfulness. I set your rules before me. I cling to your testimonies, O Lord. Let me not be put to shame. I will run in the way of your commandments when you enlarge my heart. And to me, this is proof that although a diagnosis from a doctor of an enlarged heart may be an eventual death sentence, from Jesus Christ, it's an eternal life sentence.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior and happy and blessed. Filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior.
Good evening, church. My name is Shane James. I was born in Forest Worth and Hills, partly raised in Louisville, Texas, in Denton. Growing up, my parents were alcoholics, and I became in addiction. And growing up, me and my brother, we met in prison again, and he told me, he said, you know, go meet me at church, so I'm going to go to church. And he said, when's enough is enough. So After he left there, and then I left, I went back to my addiction. He went to the ministry. Now he's the associate pastor for Church House of Nam. And now I got a message from the Lord. Says, be still and know that I'm God. So he brought me here to Teen Adult Challenge and here to turn my life around and fix, work on me and fix me, you know. So, and so the verse I stand on is 119, Psalms 119, verse 105. His words is a lamp on my feet and a light on my path. Thank you.
Hello, church. My name is Jacob. I'm 41, and I'm from Sulphur Springs, Texas. I've been at Teen Challenge now almost 17 months. And looking back, it's, man, it's real scary where I was at not too long ago. I had burned every bridge. I was lost in my addiction. I'd become addicted to drugs, addicted to gambling. And I'd also become addicted to being a thief. No one was helping me anymore. My mother changed the locks on her house and told me that I wasn't welcome there unless she was there. And I mean, I knew that that was a really, really bad spot to be in. I mean, my parents have loved me all my life, raised me up really good, raised up in church. And, you know, I was just trying to do things on my own. I forgot whose I was at some point in time. I'm not even for sure when it happened. But, man, I was so lost. So lost. And in that, I had become an absentee dad. I couldn't hold down a job. And like I said, I'd become a thief. Something that, I mean, nobody ever sets out to do any of those things. Everybody wants to be successful and be a good dad and a good employee. And I just could not find anything to feel good about myself. But, you know, the Lord will take what the devil used for bad and turn it for good. One day I got a call from a gentleman, and he said, your name's Jacob, and you were in my store about a week ago, and you stole from me. And I said, yes, sir, I was. You know, you got me. If you got me on camera, you got me, you know. And he said, I do have you on camera, but, you know, I'm not calling to tell you that I'm going to turn you into the cops, or I don't even really want my stuff back. He said it was laid on my heart that I should call you and let you know what's being stolen from you. And he said it's your soul, and the devil's doing it. I mean, that man had showed me more godliness in a 3-minute phone call than anybody had in a long, long time. And I was crying out before that to the Lord. I was crying out, telling him, Lord, I can't do this anymore. I can't do it on my own. I need help. I want to quit. I can't do it on my own. I know that you didn't die on the cross for me to run out and be a drug addict and an absentee father and to live my life in such a selfish way. And that man was the answer to my cry out. You know, he spoke about Jesus. He spoke about love. He spoke about forgiveness. He spoke about redemption. He spoke about overcoming. You know, and he told me all of it was right there, and it was Jesus, and he's just dying for me to come back to him, to turn around and to quit all that mess. And I was arrested like a couple of weeks later, and I became a trustee at the local jail, and they took us to a church, and lo and behold, the man that I stole from was there at the church. He told me that he was going to talk to the DA. And he was going to get it set because he was kind of an affluent man in our town. And he said if I wanted to go to Teen Challenge, he'd pay for it and he'd make it happen through the court. And he did. I accepted. And I mean, man, my life's just been changed. Yeah, amen. I have a peace and a joy in my heart. I have love. You know, I have restoration in my family. I have restoration with my daughter. I have a relationship with God. On a daily, I deny myself and you know, I pick up my cross. And man, it's sometimes you think it's hard or it weighs you down, but really it's setting you free. It's more free than I've ever been, you know, just to follow the Lord. The verse that I stand on is James 4:8, draw near to the Lord and he'll draw near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Thank y'all.
Honor and all the praise. There you go. Thank you, sir. There's guys back in the sound booth trying to mess with me. Somebody turned the lyrics juice off. Thank you, guys. I tell you what, man, you touched our hearts tonight. Yep. Praise the Lord. I gave you A++. That's two pluses tonight. I'd have given you a third plus, but that electrician testified. And so that put the grade down a little. Those people, electricians, come over on the boat in the Mayflower. And the senior pastor of this great church made some kind of remark about my very dear friend, one of my heroes, Brother Terry Johnson. I just love that man. Yep. He's not real comfortable with this, but my dad passed away a few months after I arrived in Texas, and then I met him. So God said, that's your model right there. So I still haven't made it, but I'm working on it. And boy, he's like Paul. He said, follow me, and you're going to get to Christ. Anyway, I just love these people. And as I was leaving Waco, I was down in Waco this morning ministering in a small church, and on the way up, I just prayed, Lord, I thank the Lord for the great service and the safe trip. I really thank the Lord a lot for safety as I drive. There's so many women drivers out on the road. And I didn't say anything bad about them. I just said there's so many on the road. My, goodness gracious, how quick you turn. Whoosh. And so it's just... Sister Snow in here. I didn't want her to hear me say anything negative. Oh, there she's over there. Oh, there she is. My goodness, I get marked down on my valuation. But anyway, I just prayed. I said, Lord, I know that I'm going to Faith Tabernacle tonight, and I look forward to it. I'm excited about it, but I know your presence is going to be there. Man, when the music started and the ministry of singing and worship, I said, man, my goodness, can I hold on? Woo! But every song they sang reminded me of my life. God's faithfulness. When I first got saved, it was on a Thursday night, and the theme of the sermon was, my hour has come. Not my sermon, the sermon I heard. But that was the message, and I knew that was my hour. And I went back. Linda and I did a couple, and Corinne, Sheba, back there at the East, and I spoke at his 50th anniversary there. But, man, I tell you what, he's been faithful. He's been faithful. Man, he's faithful. And we can rejoice every day. And then I thought about praise, and when they were saying about praise the Lord, I thought, man, you can praise him. He talks about his praise in the morning. I thought, well, you praise him in the morning when you get up, before I go do my exercise, and then you praise him at breakfast. I was sitting there at Chick-fil-A. I'm not advertising for them. I just go there because they have egg whites. And as a senior, you can get your drink free. And so I like to hit him up for that. But anyway, yesterday morning, before I went to the office, I went by Chick-fil-A, and I bowed my head and prayed because I'm thankful that I can eat that food, that I can buy it. You know, then they gave me an allowance January, and I'm waiting to get another one. But anyway, the thing is that when I finished praying, I started eating. This man must have been watching me, and he came over and he wanted to talk to me. I thought, man, Lord, I just prayed over the breakfast because I'm so thankful. I grew up with eight sisters, so I really am glad to get something to eat because those girls are like front-end loaders. But anyway, but I thought, Lord, with all that I've experienced, the scripture says in 1 Chronicles, the 16th chapter, and the verse 8 and 9, these words, give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Pray in his name. That's what it means. Make known what? Among the nations. what he has done. Sing to him. Sing praise to him. Tell of all his wonderful acts. And I thought about that. How many wonderful acts have we been experienced with? I mean, what has happened in our life that has just turned us around? And then along with that, I thought, well, what's the theme for the hour, Lord? And here it is. When you walk out here tonight, you look in the mirror, whenever you do, you call yourself a first responder. That's what I think the Lord wants all of us to be. First responders. What did he give us to help to make us first responders? First in John 3:16, the most quoted verse, most familiar verse in the whole Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him. And the other part of that is whosoever we tell. They may not all believe in him, but the Bible says his word won't return to him void. Whoever believeth in him shall be saved. And then verse 17 said, he didn't come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him may be saved. And then Romans 5:8 says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. See, we have what we need to tell them. We have such a beautiful experience tonight. You had one this morning. You've had them in the past. I've heard about it. I envy you. But what are we doing with all that we've been recipients of? Jesus said, how you like that? On top of the written word, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. The world is hungry. And he's the only one that can fill the emptiness. Jesus said, I am the door. He was raised in a carpenter shop, so he knew something about doors. Jesus said, I am the light. How you like that? And he also told us, we're the light. I went into a cleaner's one day. I'd been in there several times, and they've closed now. But when I used to go in there, there was a lady there. She was illegal in the States. So was her husband. But I tried to talk to her about the Lord and everything. And finally, one day, I walked in there, and I put my clothes on the counter, and she said, grab my arm right here. She said, look, Paul, she said, before you leave out here, she said, I've got to talk to you about Mormonism. I said, what do you want to know? She said, people been coming in here. They want to give me books and everything. She said, is it right? I said, does it lift up Jesus? Is he the answer to your life? She said, no. I said, it's wrong. I said, you don't have to be a theologian or a scholar about what's comparative religion. Read the word. See, we all have copies of it, but we neglect it. We don't meditate on it enough. That's what's going to feed us and strengthen us so we can be effective first responders. I believe if we'll rely on Jesus and ask the Holy Spirit to direct us and guide us like he did the Apostle Paul and other ones in there, my goodness, we'll see things happen and lives will change and the house will be filled. You can fill it again and again. If we'll just take the word of God and live it out instead of just packing it in, because the world's lost and Jesus died for them. The world's dark and we don't care enough. Otherwise, we would spend more time interceding for the lost. Take your phone and drive through your neighborhood and take a picture or video, whatever you do, with that phone, so that when you get into your private spot of altar. You can just review the pictures of the houses or the place of the apartment complex or whatever so that you can pray for the people in there, the souls, and you'll never lose heart. You'll never lose a perspective of it because it'll be right there on your phone. We've got to become passionately obsessed for interceding for the lost because we can sing and talk about Jesus coming. And that's good. That's exciting. But by goodness, friend, we've got to do something in response to the directive that Jesus gave us. I have a black suit. And it's, you know, one of those kinds you wear for special occasions. Funerals and weddings. Either starting a new life or you're out of here. And I had to get the thing clean. But I didn't want to go to the expensive cleaners that I saw frequently when I went to the post office. And finally, I gave in. I carried the suit in the car for probably 2 weeks almost, trying to figure out when I wanted to splurge and go to the fancy cleaners. And finally, one morning, you know the other temptation about going to that cleaners? Next door was a donut store. See, in love, is like a donut. It needs to be fresh every day. So I pulled into the cleaners. No, sir, I didn't go to the donut store that day. Anyway, so I went into the cleaners, right? I went up to the door, and the door was locked. The lights were on. So I hit the handle and just rattled. This little Korean lady came back around the counter, unlocked the door. Sure, my name is Paul Daniel Ecker. She opened the door, and I walked in. When I went to the counter, laid a suit on there, I heard the door click. She locked the door. And I told her, I said, I'm a married man. I saw the metal chair over there because I thought, you know, you learn in training people for combat, you got to find a way out of things, right? So I thought, if she moves wrong, boom, the chair's going through the window and I'm going behind it. You can't always be real spectacular, Christian, but you got to keep working on it. So anyway, she wrote down my name and my phone number. And she said to me, she said, I came from Korea about 5 months ago. And she said, my 19-and-a-half-year-old son is on drugs. And I said, why are you telling me that? She said, last night I prayed. She said, I've been praying since I came to Texas, trying to find some help for my son. And she said, last night God said, I'm going to send a man. Here, I've been fighting going in there because I didn't want to pay $7.57 to get my suit clean. But God had a different reason. He got a reason for you, wherever you are. He's got a purpose for you. All of us got some kind of ministry we can do. When I drive down the street and I look at this property, I say, man, somebody's taking care of things. Do we really appreciate it? When you walk in the door, man, I like all the friendly people and everybody speaks to you, you know. One of the ladies said, oh, you're here again. No, she didn't. No. The bottom line is Brother Tim did that, but nobody else. You can see him about it, not me. The bottom line is, she wanted to know, and I have an answer. Yes. And so do you. Yes. The answer is, the only answer to sin is Jesus Christ. We can put a fancy name on all kind of stuff, but sin is sin. If it's contrary to God, it's sin. And we've got to go tell people about it. Jesus said, I am the way. You know what we need to do? We need to be people of influence. I used to wonder when I was a younger kid hearing about leadership, and I thought, man, I'd like to be one of those. I'm still working on it. But it's amazing how the Lord put you in places. When I was stationed in the military, I went down to see the first sergeant because somebody made a mess in the third floor of barracks or whatever. I went down and told him, I said, hey, so-and-so did so. He said, Sarge, I had three stripes. He said, Sarge, he said, what would you do when you were on combat? He said, anyway, so he told me, he said,
what would you do? I said, I'd take care of it. He said, go up there and take care of it. He said, by the way, when I was walking out the door, he said, you're the new dorm chief for that three-story dorm. And he said, we got a colonel coming by Saturday for our inspection. The Lord will put you in places. He will allow you to be. What you have to do and I have to do is to say, yes, Lord. Because we place so much emphasis on this natural man. And it's okay to a degree, but the bottom line is, what are we doing with the life and the breath and the energy that and the material goods that the Lord blesses us with? I promise you, when I sit down at Chick-fil-A, I bow my head and I thank God that I've got $2 and whatever cents it is to pay for that, and they give me a free drink because I'm a senior. You see, friends, in order to be people of influence, we've got to look at the scripture. We look at Joseph's life. You remember Joseph? Huh? What he went through, what he dealt with? Huh? He avoided, he rejected temptation. He ran from it instead of to it. See, we dwell on the natural garbage instead of dwelling on Jesus. I think about the influence that he had on his brothers and others. And I think about Noah. Of course, I got sidetracked many times thinking about how he got all the material there to the job site. I mean, they didn't have wagons or, you know, lifts and Home Depot and all that stuff. But somehow he trusted in God to do the job. And he put his shoulder to the wheel. We may not always have a glowing, wonderful job to do. But friends, whatever it is, we need to do it. And for all you precious young people here that's working in the choir and some a little older than that, you're here practicing everything, I stand and applaud you for giving me your time and energy and singing to the Lord. God bless you. But don't hold it inside here. Take it out there. What we've got to do is say, Lord, I want to be an influencer in my society. I was down to East Dallas, well, down at the, what do you call it, Irving Boulevard. And it was going down to a health food store. I'm not a health food nut. I was just going down there to pick up sandwiches that were left over so I could take them down Saturday morning to the train, where the train tracks are, and hand them out to people who ride the trains and don't pay for them. You know, because they need to eat too. They need Jesus. So I went down there and I'm picking up the sandwiches. I was really unhappy. Because it was Friday and it was 4:45 and I'm on my way back from the sandwich store and the traffic wasn't moving as fast as I thought they should. That's why I like to drive according to the temperature instead of the signs. Only in the spring and the summer. And so as I'm coming around the corner, right, this pickup truck in back in front of me, he was driving real slow. I thought he must be sightseeing. And he drove so slow he stopped, and I didn't. So I made an adjustment on his fender and bumper. He rolled into the driveway. And then he put his hand up on his neck. The first thing I thought of is lawsuit. And I said, well, at least what I'm going to do is try to talk to him. So I rolled out of the van. He opened the door. I said, man, I want to pray for you. He rolled out of the car or the truck onto the ground, and I got down to pray for him. He said, I'm fine. I said to the lady looking, I said, did you see that? Hear that? So I went in to use her phone. And she said, when I got off the phone, because I had to call the police, company vehicle. And she said, what do you do? I said, I deal with people who have life-controlling problems, normally involve substance abuse. And she said, I have a family member. Can you help them? I said, man, here's my card. They didn't really want the help that we offered. But the bottom line is, we have to find some way to influence the darkness. We need to invade it. When we get up in the morning, man, we're on duty. When I go to the community center, the duty exercise, I supposed to do to keep healthy and all what I'm supposed to do. Man, I'm thinking there's somebody in there I got to talk to. I got to respond with some phrase out of the Word of God. I've got to do something to say something because I'm on God's time. How you like that? We are on God's time. He owns us. He causes us to breathe. I like Joshua as an influencer because he not only spent time with Moses, the Bible teaches that the Spirit was in him and then God raised him up. God's raising you up, not to necessarily literally cross over to Jordan, but to cross over the roadway where you live, to cross over to somebody else's place of work, to cross over to somebody's place of business and tell them about Jesus. Live it out. And find some way to just spread it around. Sometime back, it was Linda's birthday. And so I went down to the Dollar Tree to buy her a gift. Not really. They have cheap pretzels in there. That's why I like them. But after I came out of the store with the little gift for her, I had some money left over. And I thought, man, there's Aunt Annie's hot pretzels up there, and I like them. So I thought, man, I'll splurge this morning, go up and get a jalapeno hot pretzel. So I walked in that door, and I said to that lady, I said, hi. She said, hi. She said, you seem happy. I said, oh, yes, I'm very happy. She said, what do you need? I said, I need a jalapeno pretzel. I said, how long will it take? She said, several minutes. I said, I think I can spare the time. So I paid for it. She said, what makes you happy? I said, this morning, I talked to the Lord. I read the Word. She said, how long have you been married? And I told her. Oh, she said, what makes your marriage work? I said, the relationship with Jesus. I said, I'm not perfect. Linda will tell you that. None of us are. But the bottom line is, that's the stick-to-itiveness thing. That's the thing that will help you through. That's the thing that will guide you and heal things and straighten things out and help you to influence others. But we got to do something about our relationship with Him. And until we know Him, we won't trust Him. And only when we really trust Him will we step forward in boldness and tell somebody about the Jesus. I had opportunity to talk with them and pray with those two ladies. All because I wanted a jalapeno pretzel. Really, it was a God thing. That's where it all come from. You can't plan every step. I was going to go to church on a Sunday night with Linda. And the reason I wanted to go to my home church at that time, because I know that a group of the people went out after church to eat. And I always want a little morsel. Boy, am I glad the pastor's going to take us. It's been a long time since I had a good meal. You got to love him, man. Hey, listen, another thing, too. They say October's Pastor's Appreciation Month. With him, it ought to be every month. You know, every month. If he's not God's man for the hour, I'm not. I'm General Schwarzkopf, and I'm not. So the phone rang. Linda was over there on that side of the room, and it was a detective. Detective says to me, he said, you're Paul Ecker? And I said, yes, yes, yes. He said, you're Pentecostal? I said, yes, sir. I want to know how he knows so much about me. He said, I have your card. He said, I know something about the organization. I said, what can I help you with? He said, I'm over here at Circle Motel off of Harry Hines and Northwest Highway. He said, I've been stabbed in the leg. I said, well, where's your backup? He said, I didn't have a backup, didn't call one. He said, I made a mistake trying to be a show out. You don't go on a call and crazy people only by yourself. I know that much. So I said, you have a tourniquet around your leg? He said, yeah, I got a towel. I said, good, good, good. He said, you'll be all right. I said, you want me to call him? He said, no. He said, yeah, I want you to come. I said, am I going to church with my wife? He said, well, I wish you'd come. Anyway, Linda and I are going to church. I'm over there grinding because I didn't want to go. Linda's over there praying that I will go. So I finally, about a block before the church, I told her, I said, now look, if I go in the parking lot, or as we go in the parking lot, if I see anybody I trust, feel comfortable with, I said, we'll go. She said, okay. I didn't even get in the driveway. She said, there's Bill. I said, yeah, I see him. So I pulled out. She got out. I said, Bill, let's go. She told Bill, she said, Paul wants you to go with him. So he got in the car. He said, what are you going to do? I said, we're going over here and get help this detective that got messed up. He looked at me. He said, what are we going to do? I said, I don't know. We're going to know. Because I told him we'd come. When we got over there, man, God intervened. You know, we're not super people. All of us have the same potential. All of us. Don't do anything foolish. What we got to do is do what the Lord says. I have a card here. It's from a guy. They called me from the hospital sometime back. And he didn't want to go to a Dalton Teen Challenge and serve the Lord, but he didn't want to go to jail for the trouble he got into. And I told him, I said, Waylon, I said, there's a lot of things you need to straighten out. One, you got a wife and two children in El Paso. You're in Dallas, so you're out of step there. Number two, you went out and did stupid and got in trouble. You ended up in Baylor Hospital with bruises and stitches and all the other stuff that goes along with that. I said, I'm not an escape mechanism. I said, I'm here to give you opportunity to come to Jesus. He said, I'm not ready to come. So I gave him a card. I said, call me when you get serious. He said, you're not much of a Christian. Yes, I am. But I try to be a good steward of time and resources. So I left the office, or left the hospital and took off. He called me several weeks later, getting out of the hospital, right? He wanted a ride down to 20, so he'd get out of town, all that. So I went down and picked him up. Normally, I pick up hitchhikers, but, you know, I told him to get on the road and hitchhike. He gave me money for the bus. But I told him about the adult challenge in Midland, Texas. And the card says this. It says, Paul, I've been at Teen Challenge for 5 weeks, and I'm doing good. I thank you for everything you did. Pray for me. Waylon Valentine. See, friends, I have no more ability than you. All I know is God told me back in the first part of 82, he said, you go to Texas. He said, and you do what I tell you to do. And he told me to be a team player. And he told me to be a friend of the pastors. And whatever I find my hands to do, do it. Serve others. That's the thing we could all learn to do, is serve Jesus, serve as unto Jesus, because what we do is goes to him. Nothing else matters. So that's why I again emphasize, friends, we need to make it a goal that we're going to be first responders. Because Jesus is quoted in 2 Peter, the third chapter, that he's not willing, God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And we need to be likewise. Instead of being, bear with me, indifferent, nonchalant, basically, whatever comes, goes. There's some verses I was reading somewhere. We spend too much time finding fault with non-believers. Tearing them down, ridiculing them. They're not even around and we're doing it. We're dwelling on negative stuff. And man, we're going to find nothing in just everyday life. What we've got to do is say, Jesus, how can I be an influencer? Jesus was the premier example of influence. If you read the Gospels, you'll find when he went to one place, he healed, he delivered, he set free, and they came along. And think about that story about that little lady that bumped into him, huh? She just didn't bump in, and the Bible said she touched him. We got to quit just trying to bump Jesus. We got to touch Jesus. We got to quit trying to just visit the Holy Spirit. We got to walk in the Spirit. and walk upright, because we have all that we need to dress up to go into the world, the harvest field, and be a first responder. We can put on the whole armor, Ephesians 6, verse 10 and following, I think it is. And we can walk in the Spirit and have the joy of the Lord and the fruit of the Spirit. So as we go forth and become first responders, we'll see people's lives changed and their victory in their life. That's our goal. Sow the seed. Walk around with a sack around your shoulder and reach in and sow the seed and sow the seed and sow the seed. And at the end of the day, kind of take an inventory. How much seed did I sow today? Because I'm doing it as unto the Lord. Stand with me, please. It's time to pray. Every one of us. And I'm going to pray. And while I'm praying, I want you to make your way to the altar. Standing, kneeling, front row, whatever. I want you to come and pray. If you need special prayer, there's people around here that can pray with you and for you. I love it. This place has church. You're serious about it. And I love it. I admire it. I appreciate it. But don't keep it inside the walls. Take it out there. Please. Denton, Texas is getting darker and darker. I listened to the news a little also, and it's a mess. But it's your Jerusalem. And this is where God's called you. Father, I thank you for your presence in our lives. And Holy Spirit, your presence, your great presence in this place. Lord, as these precious people are coming to pray and talk to you and listen to you and spend time with you, may we come, Lord, expecting to hear from you, to confirm a direction, a person. Help us to begin to become more compassionate in our prayer so that we can intercede, so that we will intercede for others, so that we'll see lives changed and challenged and join the family of God, to have victory in their life, overcoming. Lord, help us to be determined. We're going to push back the darkness. We're going to be influencers. We're going to be first responders. We're not only going to hide the word in our heart. We're going to let it roll out of us to make a difference in our world. I thank you, Lord, for this great church, for the sincerity, for the mindset of leadership. But God, I thank you because of your faithfulness to every one of us as individuals. Help us to rejoice, to recall, to reflect, and give you praise every day, throughout the day. And we give you all the glory. In Jesus, your name we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, people, for coming. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. If you're an individual that you want special prayer, come and forth and just raise your hand, request, look at somebody and ask somebody, and I'll be watching for you because we want to pray for you. We want you to walk out of here with that relationship, with victory in your life, not just cold and indifferent, but that you're going to have an overcoming victory. Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah.